evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Mahoning Drive-In Theater, the largest single-screen drive-in in the United States. We're certainly glad you could be with us this evening. And don't forget, the concession stand is open with all kinds of great things to eat and drink.
.3 Mahoning Drive-In Radio, your old friend Virgil back once again for another exciting episode of the podcast. As you guys know, the only podcast dedicated to the revival of our beloved drive-in culture. And today we have a really, really fun one. We've been teasing these kind of segment episodes, if you will, coming up with some creative ideas to keep it fresh. And today's one of them. We're going to do something called Off the Wall, which is simply us pulling some of our favorite movies out of our collection. We were talking maybe three of those movies out of our collection and starting that conversation, talking about it, and also using it as a platform to recommend some goodies to the audience. And of course, it's not the podcast without my co-host and general manager extraordinaire, Mark. Say hello, my friend.
Hello, I am Virgil's general personal manager. Personal it feels like general manager. I show up at his house and I'm like, everything okay? Did you get that done yet? Okay, how are you doing on popcorn?
I'll tell you, it's a beautiful thing. But it's been an insanely productive off season. And as the audience knows, we've started announcing shows and they're getting crazier and crazier. And the excitement and feedback is at a good level. It's feeding our bellies. And we're feeling really, really excited. Definitely ready for the weather to get warm. Whenever it's we're in this season, it just kind of makes me blah. How about you with the cold, Mark?
Not personally a fan of the cold. Not personally a fan of the heat nor humidity. I don't like it if it's too dry either.
Yeah,
I like it when it's like Goldilocks. I like it when it's just right.
Yes, as we all do for sure. Before we jump into this, we also have Jeff kind of waiting. I guess he's probably busy at work, but we're hoping to get him jumping on the line at a certain point. So we're going to start. I think he's going to be prepped with some movies to talk about as well. And Mark, was that the idea? We'll kind of jump in with a couple titles out of our collection.
Yeah, I think we could just go around and I said, let's pick three and we'll just talk about a film from our collection that we like and any personal memories and then general chit chat about it or condemnation. And then we'll tell the people listening whether we think they would like it or not. Because in some cases, I might recommend a movie and go, this is probably not for you.
Well, we were chatting about it before we hit record, but the physical media situation for us, it's out of control. I mean, it always has.
The word is troubling.
Yeah, it always has been in my life because, as the fans know, I grew up running a video store for 7 years. Naturally, you acquire a ton of media in that run. We are all three of us, vinyl record collectors. So that builds a whole other area of the household and collection. And it gets really hard to, for me, really hard to remember sometimes, what do I own? You know, when you're flipping through a million records at the record store or digging through at a thrift store or something, all these DVDs. And it's funny because you had a different one than me. I use something called iCollect and they're not paying us for this at all. It's the one that I chose because there seems to be a bunch out there.
This is a phone app?
It's an iPhone app. And you just simply scan the UPC code if it's got one on the back of the physical media, whether it's a VHS tape or whatever type of media, and you can log it into your personal collection. And the thing I love about it is you can choose the format or the barcode, I guess sometimes we'll know. But that's the hard thing too, is I've become a big VHS collector and the revival VHS, I don't know what I have sitting somewhere in a box from the old Hollywood video days versus up on the shelf, you know? So it's been really nice to, at least in my pocket, be able to go to a simple app that's just like, hey, here it is. What do you use? What's your, and honestly, I think the way I found it, I just searched probably in the, you know, app store collection tracker or something.
I've used for years a program called DVD Profiler. It used to be a web-based, like a website where you would have a login and you could keep track of what you owned by typing in the title or the UPC numbers or scanning them. And you could share that with friends. So friends could see what you have. Like, you know, the glory of physical media was if you have some rare thing and your friend wants to watch it, you just hand it to them. There's no complicated process. It's not like now if you DVR something and you want a friend to see it, it's like, how do I get this to, how many laws do I break to do that? So DVD Profiler started as a website, and then I've sort of let it slide for many years. And then I found it again as a free downloadable program. So it's actually on my laptop. There is a phone app as well that I think is you have to pay for, but I'm cheap. So I just use the free laptop program. And it, it puts in the cover art, the description, the cast. So it gives you a database so you can search. So you're like, you know, do I have a Henry Rollins film in my collection? I want to watch, have a Henry Rollins film festival. You could type that in and bring it up, or directors, right, or something. You can also designate where you bought it, how much you paid for it. So you can see what your collection cost you out of pocket, or if you want to sell it to see if you can recoup a cost or something.
Wow, that's cool too.
It breaks it down really, really in a lot of detail, but it also allows you to say where the location is, which I like, because you can, if you lend something out, you can put a note in there as to who you lent it to. So you can literally see where your stuff is.
Oh my God, that happened.
Yeah. It's almost like set up to, back. It makes you think.
Track those people.
Yeah, yeah. Carl is a deadbeat. No. It's like software intended for a video store. So you can track all your stuff that way, which is cool. And for me, I moved a few years ago and I had a room. I was called it the vault, where I had all my media stuff. So I always wanted it all in one space so I could just close the door and it was all safe. And when I moved, that all couldn't go to one place where I'm living. So it is actually spread across three states and like four or five locations. So I always say it's going to take like five fires to wipe out my collection. But this helps me
figuring it out,
you know, designate where stuff is currently too. So yeah, DVD Profiler is great. And I've it's strange as it may seem, I could never tell you what I own. If so you said, tell me everything you own, I couldn't do it. I've got a lot, but I've always been conscious when I'm looking at things, like I know what I have. Like if I'm in a place with 1,000 used movies, I can look around and pretty much know what I have. But there was a period, right, not long before I moved, where physical media started to decline and all these companies were having these massive sales where you can buy stuff dirt cheap. And I buy by the pound when I buy used stuff or cheap stuff. So it would be like, you know, Hamilton book. By the way, you want a hot tip on where to get really inexpensive DVDs and Blu-rays? HamiltonBook.com. Again, not a paid endorsement here. They're the equivalent of the old remainder bin at bookstores and things like that. So they get a lot of stuff from a lot of companies, a lot of cool niche boutique labels too. And you can get, I actually happen to have a stack of things next to me that came from there. And it's like, I Escaped from Devil's Island and The Final Option from Shout Factory, Fox Bat from Code Red, Get Mean from Blue Underground. Yeah, all that stuff. And it was all really inexpensive. So all these places would be having sales and Black Friday sales and everything. And I wound up having just like boxes of discs I haven't watched yet that I bought new. So that pushed me over into the realm of I might now possibly buy something I already had. But before then, it was always just like somehow in my mind. So that's where this kind of software, especially if you have in your pocket and you're out and about, is like huge to be able to just go, do I have a copy of Cannibal Women in the Avocado Jungle of Death? Yes, I do.
Why, yes, I do.
And I actually literally do have that next to me right now. But anyway.
Shelves. And being at the theater, you know, it's we get donations, constantly donations of all sorts of different media. And yeah, I can relate to that because, you know, I'm a big thrift store guy as well. And you go to a thrift store and they have bins upon bins of old media that's they're literally trying to blow out. It just gets tough. And it's nice to have a little reminder.
We should and will talk about this when we get closer to our VHS Fest event that we do every year. But I was a video store hound as a kid. And it was a lot of independent video stores. We didn't really have chains in my town until pretty late in the game. And they would often sell off extra copies or titles that were like the least rented titles. So for years, I was buying used tapes. And then a couple of video stores near me, in the scheme of things, not that long ago, finally started getting rid of their VHS tapes, and they were giving them away. So I got hundreds of VHS tapes from these really amazing super video superstores. And I had a video store shelf from one of those stores that went out of business in my little vault room that was filled with these ex-rental VHS tapes. So I hear you when I say, when you say you have a lot of movies. So when you bring up this off the wall, in previous years, I had a room I could go to. And if you said pick whatever, what's your favorite this or pick five, I would literally go in and look at my shelf. I actually don't have a shelf right now. So this is like this, this game of trying to remember
it's
what
like
I have.
Out the box or under the bed. Or...
I actually do have a few under the bed boxes I bought for where we are now with a bunch of discs that I've since, you know, acquired. And like you said, we don't stop getting discs. Like,
it's endless.
I came into this space having no discs, and now there's probably several hundred here that I've picked up here and there. So I don't have a shelf per se, but I got piles.
Well, since we're waiting for Jeff, why don't we start with, you said we had a fan voicemail, which it's a good time to let folks know what's that all about. It's been a while since we've plugged ye old voicemail.
Yeah, so we use anchor.fm to send this podcast out to the world. There are other ways to hear this podcast. You may be listening to it on YouTube. If so, hi, subscribe and leave a comment, as they say. You may be listening to it through our Patreon page, but primarily we send the file to anchor.fm/Mahoning Drive-In, and there it disseminates, which sounds dirty, this podcast to various podcast services, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google, all that stuff. And through our anchor.fm/Mahoning Drive-In page, there's a button that's called message or leave a message. And there people can leave voice messages for us. And we always encourage people to do that, and we'll play them on the show. And they limit you to like 59 seconds. So what you'll have to do, and what this person did, is if you have more than 59 seconds of material to tell us, just leave us several, and we'll string them together. And the listener, like you right now, will hear it as one continuous message. But we always encourage people, if we talk about anything you want to add to, if it sparks any drive-in memories, if you want to tell us about your drive-in that you currently go to or used to go to as a kid, what movies you remember seeing at drive-ins, anything related to anything we're talking about, we'll feature that in a future show, because it's cool and we like to hear it too. We want to learn and share your memories and joy. So one of our regular listeners, Ron Heffelfinger, left us a message, which I will play for us for the first time. And you said a fan left a message. I haven't listened to this yet, so this could be an irate customer leaving us a message.
They're asking about details of like, how do I order tickets?
So we're taking this journey together, folks.
Hey guys, it's Ron Heffelfinger. I had left a message a while back about some of the double features I had seen at the Mahoning over the years. And after listening to your most recent podcast about your drive-in memories and some of the other drive-ins you've visited, I felt like maybe I wanted to share some of my experiences with that too. First of all, I want to thank you again for all the things you do. This is great to be able to have this kind of thing paying tribute to drive-in movie theaters. I lived about 5 minutes away from Becky's, so my earliest memories are from there. I remember going to see some Elvis movies with my parents, a lot of Disney films. I remember Bambi, and specifically the Boatniks, Jungle Book, the original Herbie the Love Bug. And as I said in my previous message, after Becky's went to adult theaters, we shifted over to Schenkweiler's. Probably didn't go as often because it was a little farther away. But when I started driving, I did spend a lot of time at Schenkweiler's. Actually had a crush on one of the snack bar attendants. Just probably spent a little more time there than necessary. When I met my wife, I think I mentioned previously too that we spent a lot of time at the Limerick Drive-In movie theater, which Jeff eventually managed. And we spent some time there until we got married. We moved into the Lehigh Valley after we got married. So at that time, spent a lot of time at the Bethlehem Drive-In. They seemed to be getting the best of the first run movies. I remember seeing Tim Burton's Batman there, the original one with Michael Keaton. Saw quite a few other movies that were brand new. We saw Total Recall there. We saw Good Morning Vietnam with Cocktail. Remember that double feature? A lot of other first-run flicks. I think we saw a few of the Friday the 13th there. Some of the drive-ins I visited as a child that I don't have too many memories of, but I know we visited were the Starlight in Easton. These are some of the same ones I think Jeff might have mentioned in his podcast. The Boulevard Drive-In, the Super Skyway. That happened to be my favorite too. I remember when you pulled up, the back of the screen was visible with some neon lights and stars that looked like it was the sky lit up. I just thought that was really cool as a background as you drove up to the theater in the dark. There was another theater that I actually don't remember ever visiting, with the West End Drive-In. It was right off of Route 22 and 15th Street. There was a car on the back of their screen, and the wheels would light up to make it look like the car was moving. I thought that was pretty cool too, and we saw that often when we went by. Matter of fact, I have a quick story about that. One time when I was about 8 years old, I got poison ivy from head to toe, and had seen a doctor, but the medicines they gave me weren't helping too much, so I had to go to the ER. And I remember driving by there, seeing the screen all lit up, and could see the movie was The Million Dollar Duck, a Disney movie with Dean Jones. And as miserable as I was going to the hospital, I wanted my parents to stop on the way back so that we could watch that movie. I was always kind of mesmerized by drive-ins. Some of the biggest memories I have as a teenager were from the Boulevard Drive-In. And that was one you guys talked about at length on the podcast too. I remember they kind of had a wide variety of movies. For a while, they were doing like triple features of the soft porn movies. Then they were doing pretty much the same thing with horror. And they would always repeat the first movie. So you were actually seeing four movies when you went there. They went back into more mainstream for a little while. I remember seeing Stripes there, Porky's. Saw some of the Freddy Krueger movies there too. But some of the memories I have as a teenager, it was kind of a party place. You could go there, nobody seemed to bother you if you were going to do a little drinking and maybe carry on a little bit. But one thing I do remember about all the drive-ins I went to is I don't think sitting out on chairs or on blankets was a real big thing at the time. Remember sitting in the back seat of a car, or when I was driving in the front seat. But at the Boulevard, I remember some of the nights just got so stinking hot to sit in a car with 3-4 guys. So we found out that they had some older, I guess you'd call them lounge chairs. Remind me of something my grandparents had up by the projection booth. My one friend and I would often go up there to watch the movies. They had a speaker out there so you could hear, you know, just as well as you could out of the car speakers. Awesome. And we would sit there and just kind of chill out and watch the movies from there. And I do remember quite a few times we would sit and watch the three movies, and sometimes even rewatch the first one over again. And you're talking, you know, probably like 3 in the morning till the last movie was over. And I do remember, you know, waking up in those chairs with a stiff neck after falling asleep because it got so late. Those are just some of the memories I had. Hopefully people found them somewhat entertaining. Again, thanks for everything you guys do, and long live the drive-in.
Oh, thank you, Ron. That is gold.
Absolute gold. And you can tell he's such a fan. He made a point from his whole childhood all the way on to just like make the drive-in a part of his routine, part of his life. We got Jeff on the line. Jeff, what's happening, my friend? You were able to hear the voicemail?
Yes.
How great is that? How great is that?
Fantastic.
Do you recall those memories? That neon sounds amazing.
Yes, on the back of the Super Skyway. Yes, they were planets. You had Saturn, you had a couple others, and they were all lit up in neon. It was really, the Super Skyway, the back of the screen was really cool. It was really neat.
I'm such a sucker for neon. Even yesterday, we were driving on Long Island during the day, and there was a liquor store that had neon, and I was like the little kid that sees the zoo as you're driving by. Only for me, it's neon. And it's just like, oh, neon! Even stories about neon and how beautiful and unique and artistic it used to be on these various theaters. The theater that had the neon of the car that looked like the wheels were turning, that's just amazing.
Yeah, that was the West End Drive-In. We went to that one
And he shared with us stories of the Boulevard, which I find endlessly fascinating because they were like the most drive-in of drive-ins that in my research that I've been doing for the Mahoning. And for our Patreon people, I put on every week a flashback post where I use old newspaper ads for the Mahoning and talk about what we played in decades past. But I've also started putting some up for other regional drive-ins. And the Boulevard is one I just got into. And they were the ones, as Ron said, they would do the softcore triple features and they would do the horror triple features. And their programming was just like an Exhumed fan's, you know, dream.
Yeah.
If we could only go back in time, you know, that's my thing. When I hear about these settings that I wasn't able to take advantage of or just wasn't on my radar for whatever case, it would just be so nice to see these things in their heyday. But it reminded me of a story when he talked about waking up on those lounge chairs. I think I talked about how the Bucks County Twin, it's split in the middle by the concession stand, but behind the concession stand's a big kind of gravel hill, you know, kind of a steep hill, honestly. And if you sit at the top of it, you know, you're looking over the concession stand and you can view both screens. You look to the right, it's the one screen, look to the left, it's the other. But I remember as a kid specifically, I don't remember what the movie was, but I remember falling asleep on that hill, you know, because we used to go and play on it and waking up. And it's just like, gosh, you know, talk about such a divine kind of situation for a child waking up in a place like that. It's like a dreamland.
I saw some photos on one of the, I don't think it was, it could have been Cinema Treasures. It was something similar to that. Somebody had posted a bunch of photos of the Boulevard drive-in after it had closed, but before it was torn down. And you did see some of those exterior chairs that were facing the screen in front of the snack bar that Ron was talking about. And these, in this photo though, they looked like they were wooden theater chairs, you know, with where the seats fold up. But they were, yeah. I've been to a couple drive-ins that do that. They have chairs outside facing the screen against the snack bar. So you can sit out there like with your food and watch, and they have a speaker right above you. So you don't, the sound is good. And there were theaters that did have in the snack bar rows of seats indoors, like behind a big plate glass window where you could sit and watch the movie while you ate, almost like rows of theater seats. Some had tables where you could eat your food and not miss the movie. But I thought the ones that were interesting, one or two that I've seen where it was almost like a little indoor theater at a drive-in.
Right, they had a big plate glass window that you could look out of and see the screen and also hear the sound from a speaker. Yeah, I saw a couple that were designed that way, that you could do that. Most were not, most were like ours. I remember Ron mentioned the Limerick Theater, which was the highway drive-in that I ran, right there in Limerick, basically. But we had park benches outside that you could sit and watch the movie.
That's a really fun appeal, you know what I mean? To be able to have, you know, the outdoor seating option. Yeah. And, you know, like you said, and you guys have mentioned it as well, that just wasn't a thing
for
a long time. You were in the car.
Right. Yes. Yeah. Even when I was little. Yeah. That was not a thing. Everybody was in their cars.
I do remember it came up on one of the recent podcasts about somebody being envious of the kids that could put the sleeping bags on the roofs.
Yeah. I was always parents.
Yeah. And I do remember, you know, the kids that could get up on top and had the kind of cool outdoor setups. Although a lot of my memories, you know, of the drive-in fall like 90s era, like late 80s, 90s era. So, you know, by that point, all my memories going to the drive-in at least had that back gate open on the car, back hatch open on the back of the car, and we'd all sit in there. Or we were all outside. I guess that was just the kind of bag then.
Yeah, that was the era of your main drive-in memories is the era when I rediscovered the drive-in. And I was going to the Northfield drive-in and the Milford drive-in in New Hampshire. And when I was a kid and the kids were in sleeping bags on the roofs, those were all mostly regular sized cars. And it was one of those screens that was sort of, the screen image was rather high up off the ground, kind of like ours. So there really wasn't, it wasn't larger vehicles like you see now. So the kids on the roofs, they were never anywhere near my field of vision for the screen image. Like they were never in the way. I think that would be different now with larger vehicles and things where, you know, the height, you can't put your hatch all the way up because you might block the person behind you. Back then the cars were all relative, even though they were wide and long, they were not really tall.
Yeah, exactly.
And our theater has the humps as well, which lends to that, the fact that if you're parking properly,
Yeah, I can't count the number of people that have no idea how those humps work at our drive-in. It's the funniest thing. They'll park the dumbest ways. They're probably some of them thinking, why are these humps here?
How inconvenient.
That's one of the things I've always loved about the Mahoning, even as a customer, was that the ramps are still really steep.
Yes.
Because a lot of theaters I've been to, including one I mentioned earlier, there are almost no ramps whatsoever. You're like in a parking lot. And that means you can only get so close to the screen before you have to like put your head on your dashboard to be able to see the image, because it's a bad viewing angle. But with ours, everybody's pointed up and right at the screen.
Right. Exactly. Yep.
Yeah, the ramps lend to that viewing experience for sure. And the fact that our screen is raised, like you said. I can't remember for the life of me, at least the Bucks, how their screen sat. But even Shanks, when I went to Shanks recently, they're sitting up on like a little hill, but their screen's practically like on the ground, you know?
Yeah.
Thanks for coming to our show tonight. We appreciate the opportunity to serve you. We think it's great to be able to enjoy fine entertainment in the comfort and privacy of your own car. The come-as-you-are atmosphere is a pleasant way to relax in the evening. Don't you agree?
But anyway, Jeff, we're talking about making this an off-the-wall episode where we talk about fun movies or movies that we love that are in our collection that we can just pull off the wall and chat about a little bit and maybe use it as a recommendation for the folks out there. But yeah, that was an amazing voicemail. So like Mark said, if you guys want to get in on the fun of the podcast here, jump on over to the Anchor page and leave us a voicemail. Wouldn't it be cool if we had like an actual number people could call, like 555 ask Mark something? Yeah.
That would be
the recording would say, we're closed.
Yeah. Even when we played this, Jeff, we were like, we didn't hear it before. So we're like, maybe it's just somebody asking for directions. What do we get there?
Virgil said we have a fan message. I'm like, we don't know it's a fan. It could be quite the opposite. You never know.
All right. So yeah, why don't we jump into this? Hopefully you guys have some goodies that you want to share with the folks out there. Well, it didn't take too long. We were talking about it, Jeff, that I actually, nowadays, the collection's out of hand. And sometimes I forget when I'm out shopping what I have and what I don't have.
Right.
So I'm going to pull out my handy dandy app that helps me keep track of the collection. For me, my first choice off the wall was actually a documentary. And the reason I chose it is I know that maybe it's an appeal for people that when the three of us are on an episode, we really touch different generations, you know?
Yeah.
Like a lot of my drive-in memories, like I said, come from late 80s, early 90s. Mark's sit a little bit earlier. Jeff's sit a little bit earlier than that.
Yeah.
And that can be the case with the movies as well. And a lot of the movies that I have discovered over my lifetime may have just been a part of your guys' fabric. So the reason I chose this one is it really opened up my eyes to 70s cinema. And 70s cinema was something that I just was not around for. And being at the time, film school kid, I found this movie at the perfect time. I was running the video store. It's one that I just found on the shelf. It came in with the deliveries every single week. There was only two copies of it, which, you know, you knew it was kind of a smaller release. But the name of this movie, this documentary, is called A Decade Under the Influence, the 70s films that changed everything. This was an IFC release and actually was the last movie that Ted Demme worked on before he tragically passed away. Ted Demme, Jonathan Demme's brother. But the reason I love this movie, it goes deep into detail on how the 70s really was a big shift in cinema and kind of what you would see on the screen. 60s had a lot of the bubblegum still. You would see a lot of kind of the big movie musicals being the big hits of the day, where 70s really challenged that. And you started getting these really edgy, gritty stories and characters. And
yep.
I love how it goes into detail on some of these key films that really did shift how movies were not only received to theaters, but received by audiences. So for me, it's forever I will have this that I actually got from the video store. It still actually has the Hollywood Video barcode on here. So I don't know how I acquired it, but we'll just leave it at that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't recommend it enough, especially for somebody who might be in that position where they're like trying to, you know, really inform themselves on the deeper impact that cinema had at a certain time. And this does a really, really great job of capturing that. I know it might not be one that either of you guys saw, but hey, I'll put it on your radar too.
Yeah, great. Sounds great.
Great interviews too. They have Scorsese and Sissy Spacek and Robert Towne and Sidney Lumet. And I remember Friedkin was on there and he was hilarious. But yeah, that's a great one. Check that out. Jumped right off the shelf when I was scanning. So hopefully you guys dig it.
I haven't seen that. I know there was also a documentary made out of the book Easy Riders, Raging Bulls, which was similar, about the maverick cinema of the late 60s into the 70s. It's an era that I love. It's the era I was born in, so I'm kind of endlessly fascinated by it because I have some memories of it, but I tend to gravitate toward that era in movies. So, and I'm a sucker for documentaries. 9 times out of 10, that's what I'm going to dial up if I'm poking around the streaming services for something to watch. So thank you for the recommendation.
And there's so many movie documentaries out there. And, you know, I'm, like you said, I'm a sucker for all of them. You know, I'm a guy who grew up on DVD special features. So it's like, if you're giving me content that is hyper-focused on a movie, I'm in. But something like this, I felt like at the time, I think it was released in maybe 2002, right before Demi passed away. And yeah, I was just graduating from high school, so I might not have even been in college yet. But it hit me at the perfect time as far as opening up my eyes to the importance of 70s cinema and really sent me down a rabbit hole of exploration of movies where I'm like, literally, I remember writing down furiously watching this documentary, like, gotta see that, gotta see that, oh, gotta see that. So I love a movie that can do that, that can really inspire. You know, at that time, I was so on fire with film.
Film business was, you know, a decadent, decaying, emptied whorehouse, and it had to be assaulted.
This is a movie about a generation of filmmakers who shook up the system and woke up the world.
No one's saying anything. Let's say something. Let's make stories about what is. There's so much going on. What are we feeling?
Suddenly you could do things that maybe you couldn't have done 5 years earlier.
The energy was unbelievably high.
I asked for a yellow light and a red light and a green light. That's all I asked for.
I don't care if it's a B movie.
I'm going in there and I'm going to kill
you. If you were looking for the single defining phrase that motivated the filmmakers at that time, it would probably be moral ambiguity.
This world was new and open, and anything was possible.
A decade under the influence. No rules, no limits. No wonder these filmmakers changed our world.
The Last Picture Show.
The Exorcist.
Bonnie and Clyde.
Woman Under the Influence.
Easy Rider.
Deliverance. Chinatown.
Unmarried Mother. Network.
Jaws.
IFC Films presents A Decade Under the Influence, directed by Richard LeGravenaise and Ted Denny. Coming soon to a theater near you.
What do you got, Mark? What's your first pull off the wall?
Well, let's, and again, you know, I ramble so much in these shows. I very well may have talked about all these movies before, but if you've never heard it before, it's new to you. We'll connect it to the 70s and we'll connect it to the drive-in. This is a movie I saw at the drive-in in, now I want to say 1976, the year it came out, but film exhibition was a little bit different back then. You might see a movie a year later. Movies got re-released, especially with drive-ins. They hung around for a while pre-home video. So let's say it was 1976. This is The Pink Panther Strikes Again. This is my favorite of the Pink Panther movies. I love them. They were on TV all the time when I was a kid, and I clearly remember seeing this one in the theater. The memory I have is the big Claremont drive-in theater drive-in screen and the moment where Peter Sellers is dressed as a mountaineer and he's trying to get into Inspector Dreyfus's castle stronghold, and he just keeps falling into the moat repeatedly. And these movies were like, if somehow you've never seen a Pink Panther movie, yes, Steve Martin made a couple in more recent years, but originally there were this film series that started in 64, I believe, with the Pink Panther, where Peter Sellers played this inept French police inspector, Clouseau, who was on the trail of David Niven as the notorious Phantom, a jewel thief, and Robert Wagner was in it. And Peter Sellers was really kind of a marginal character in that movie, but it was so popular that it turned into this series of films. So they did two in the 60s, and then about a decade later, they came back with The Return of the Pink Panther, or Pink Panther Returns, I can't remember how exactly the title. And then the sequel to that was Pink Panther Strikes Again that we're talking about. The plot is basically Inspector Clouseau is an idiot who somehow always manages to solve the crime by accident. His boss is Inspector Dreyfus, played by Herbert Lahm, who is this man driven to like insanity by how frustrated he is with this idiot who gets all the credit and somehow gets the job done. At the end of Return of the Pink Panther, we see Inspector Dreyfus in a padded cell. He's gone insane out of his hatred for Clouseau. Pink Panther Strikes Again opens with him breaking out and getting these master criminals together. And he has a death ray. It's very cartoonish. He has a death ray that he's threatening the world with. And all he wants is the world to deliver Clouseau to him so that he can kill him and put him out of his misery. And it's very cartoonish. It's very Looney Tunes, you know, it's very Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner kind of stuff. But it was exactly the kind of humor that really just hit me hard as, God, what, a two-year-old, which is this, and I still find it hilarious. So what does that say about my sense of humor? I think it's really, really funny. It's laugh out loud for me, funny for me still when I watch it. And yeah. I could watch this movie at the drop of a hat. So highly, highly recommended. It's a movie that's never been hard to find on video. I remember renting it on VHS and I owned it on DVD. And now Shout Factory a few years ago put out a Blu-ray set of just about all of the Pink Panther films. There was one, I think Return isn't part of that because a different company owns the rights to it. And they didn't put out the last two Pink Panther movies, Curse of the Pink Panther, or the last three. I don't think they put that in there. Curse of the Pink Panther, which starred Ted Wass as some other inept American police officer who is hired to find Clouseau. See, Peter Sellers dies like around 1980 or so. And somehow Blake Edwards and UA are able to keep cranking out Pink Panther movies. Trail of the Pink Panther is this movie that was made up with some outtakes and some people dressed as Clouseau whose face you don't see, where it's Joanna Lumley. Clouseau has disappeared.
And I've never seen that. They pushed that out after.
Yeah. It is a bizarre exercise. They shot Trail of the Pink Panther and Curse of the Pink Panther about the same time. It's all the bit players. It feels like a Pink Panther movie, but you don't really see Clouseau. It's Joanna Lumley as this investigative reporter interviewing people from the other movies about him. And you see like greatest hits clips and you see sequences that were deleted scenes from the other movies, some of which are pretty funny. And it's her trying to find him. And in the end she does. And he is played by an extremely popular actor doing a Clouseau voice. And the idea is that he's had plastic surgery. And then it's weird. Some people said it was sort of like defiling a corpse. It, like it was trying to wring money out of a dead actor.
How dare they?
Yeah.
And then Curse came along in 83, like 2 years later. And that was Ted Wass as this guy. And the idea is that Interpol or some international agency is trying to hire somebody to find Clouseau. And Inspector Dreyfus sabotages it and says, no, don't give me the best detective in the world. Get me the worst. And like Clouseau, he ass backwards falls into being successful. That movie didn't really do anything. And then like early 90s, there was Son of the Pink Panther with Roberto Benigni as the son of the Pink Panther.
That I remember. Yeah, it's and then there's Bob Kennedy. Steve Martin reboot.
It's Blake Edwards. It really feels a lot like a Pink Panther movie, and it has a lot of the original supporting players. They bring back Cardia Cardinale, who was in the first movie as the princess, who was the titular diamond, Pink Panther diamond. They bring her back playing the Elkie Summer character from Shot in the Dark, which is a little, you gotta get your head around that. But I like Roberto Benigni. It's just, to me, Peter Sellers is Clouseau, and that's what a Pink Panther movie is.
Yeah, that's one you can't put another person in those shoes.
I saw the second of the Steve Martin ones to review for the show that I do, and I actually thought there were a few sequences that were really funny in it. But to me, Peter Sellers was Clouseau when you watched it. And with the Steve Martin movies, it's Steve Martin doing a weird accent.
Reaching, yeah.
So it didn't really work for me. But that's a roundabout way of saying I highest recommendation possible for Pink Panther Strikes Again.
Heck yeah.
High in the Bavarian Alps, a madman has created a doomsday machine. He has threatened to destroy the world unless the world destroys Inspector Clouseau.
Give me Clouseau.
What's a Clouseau?
I expect you're all wondering why I asked you here.
He's back again. Peter Sellers as Inspector Clouseau in his newest, most baffling case, The Pink Panther Strikes Again. Rated PG, parental guidance suggested.
Jeff, what do you got for the folks?
Well, I always go back to my favorite movie of all time, and that's Kiss of Death, Victor Mature, Richard Widmark, 1947. It just, it's film noir, it's dark. Victor Mature plays a guy who, he robs a jewelry store, then he gets caught, but he won't name any of his accomplices, and they eventually talk him into it so that he can get out of jail early instead of doing his whole sentence. And and Richard Widmark is one of the creeps that, you know, he worked with. And so then Richard Widmark kind of comes after him. It's really a good movie. It's a good old 20th Century Fox film noir. It's just great. I've always loved it. And, you know, I'll pull that off the shelf whenever I can and watch it. It's just fantastic. I don't know what else to tell you about it because it goes way back, I know, but if you ever get the chance to see it, you should watch it. It's really good, especially the last scene where Victor Mature is telling Richard Widmark off. They're in this restaurant sitting across the table from each other, and he says, you know, Victor Mature says, if you ever bother my family again, you know, and he's going into this, and he says, you know, peddle your papers, go on, blow, you know, and he's just really great. It's really great.
Yeah, I'm a sucker for those classic noir and certainly the kind of gangster era film. Yeah, that falls right in a sweet spot. And looking at it, Henry Hathaway, who directed that movie, also directed True Grit and a bunch of other titles throughout his career that you guys would recognize. Man, that's what I'm going to have to dig back into. I feel like I might have seen it on, you know, one of those noir collections that the studios were putting out for a while, which I wish they still did. There's not enough of them.
Right.
For a while, when the DVD thing exploded and it was for sure here to stay, the studios, some of them, did an amazing job of packaging their library and trying to put it out in a physical sense. But at the same time, I look at my shelf and I'm like, oh my gosh, that's a huge box.
Yeah.
Or what, 10 movies, stops, something like that?
Well, 20th Century Fox was pretty good at putting out their old film noir movies. So, yeah, you can get the Kiss of Death on DVD, yes.
Yeah. Well, that I do. I mean, as much as we are physical media lovers, the fact that there are so many different streaming sites now, it's like every studio has one. It's like, oh, do I want to watch something by Warner Brothers? Let me head over to HBO. Do I want to see something by Paramount? Let me head over to their Paramount Plus. It's so strange how all the media, even not physical, is kind of broken up into these different extensions of the studio in a virtual sense, you know?
Right.
And TCM is still good. They still have their Noir Alley series. If you have cable, if you don't, there's a TCM app. I'm not sure exactly the name of it, but I think they have all the same content that you can get on. And HBO Max also has a TCM hub, they call it a subset. So there's a good amount available on streaming. And then companies like VCI, I believe, have had these long running sets of noir films. They're not the studio pictures. They're more of the independents and smaller, maybe Poverty Row stuff. And I think VCI maybe has put out some of the Hammer, VCI or Kino. I think Kino's done a bunch of noir too, but Hammer, who's known predominantly as for horror, did some black and white noir stuff in England in the 50s. So that's out there too. So I took a class on film noir when I was in college, and it was film noir films and novels. So we got into Raymond Chandler and Dashiell Hammett and all that stuff. So I have a really soft spot for that. And I love the tough guy talk too. So I'm a sucker.
Yeah.
I've not had many opportunities to see this kind of stuff on the big screen once in a while, theaters will do repertory. They tend to hit the same titles, but I think Kiss of Death is up there in some of the, one of the most respected of the noir films. So if you live somewhere with a art house or repertory theater, you might be lucky enough to see that on the big screen one day.
Oh, that'd be a dream if we could get that one. You know what? We did the Gangster Weekend, but we've never leaned into noir, like just done a noir night.
No, we did that. We did the Gangster Weekend the one time and we never brought it back. And I'll be the first to admit we didn't do as well that night as I thought we would do, but I think we should repeat that. I think we should do that again sometime.
That was early days. I want to say 2015 or something.
Oh,
like
yes,
that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Good evening, Mr. and Mrs. North and South American. All the ships at sea, let's go to press. This is Walter Winchell broadcasting from Hollywood. I just came from a projection room at 20th Century Fox Studios where I saw a picture of my town, New York, and my time now. Ladies and gentlemen, the title of this moving picture is Kiss of Death. In underworld lingo, kiss of death can be many things, none of them good. A pat on the shoulder from a pal that turns into a bullet in the back, or a kiss from a woman's warm lips that sends the victim to the morgue. Like Boomerang and the house on 92nd Street, this one has authenticity stamped all over it. It is red meat. It is factual. It's a close-up of the tenderloin in action. Its tempo is terrific. And its story is that of a squealer. In underworld code, a squealer is marked for death. One man sneered at the code, squealed, and didn't die. That's what makes Kiss of Death such a gripping and exciting moving picture.
Kids like to have fun. We'll all have some fun together. You and me and your wife and your kids. Touch my family and you'll hear singing like you never heard before. Go on, beat it.
If you like action as I do with entertainment, you will find it here. This one was written with a machine gun.
So the next one off the shelf for me is a memory that I have seeing it actually at the drive-in. It's a film called If Looks Could Kill from 1991 with Richard Grieco, which you guys might recall from 21 Jump Street. He was the Johnny Depp sidekick in that show.
And Booker.
Yes, and Booker. This movie caught me totally off guard. I did not watch that show. And at the time, 91, I may have seen a few James Bond movies, but pretty much this movie is a James Bond ripoff. And this high school student is going on a trip with his Spanish class to Spain for whatever. And he gets mistaken for an FBI agent and he kind of gets sucked into this secret agent world with cool gadgets, cool cars, shoes that walk up walls, which was, as a kid, I was like so blown away by. And remember, I was 8, I guess, when this movie came out. So it's a total kids kind of fantasy. And looking back on it now, I have the VHS tape, which I remember, again, we bought it whenever it came out. It was way too expensive. I loved this movie and watched it almost every summer and was one of those kind of escape guilty pleasure movies. And again, as I'm scanning my collection of movies that and undoubtedly everybody knows, you know, this is one that popped out and just had really good fun memories. And I actually watched it, I guess it was within the last year or two. And it's really fun. You know, there's so many lines that I remember from it. It's kind of what would easily be described as like 90s cheese. You could easily write it off. But for me, that's the era, I think, of kind of easy guilty pleasure movies that either caught me at the right time or I saw in the right setting or purchased, you know, and was a regular watch. So that VHS popped right out. I know for some people, they're like, man, what a bummer. Richard Grieco.
That's one of those movies that it falls into the category of a Bond gap filler, because that was a period of time between Bond movies. That was after License to Kill and before Bond came back with Brosnan in GoldenEye. So you did get these other movies. They tended to be comedies more often than not. They still do. They tend to more be spy comedies than anybody really wanting to give Bond a run for its money in spy movies. But that was directed by William Dear, who did Harry and the Hendersons a couple of years earlier.
Oh my goodness, I didn't realize that.
And he did one of my favorites that if I haven't talked about on the show, I eventually will. He did a movie called Time Rider with Fred Ward from 82 that I saw in the theater. And it was produced by Mike Nesmith. And it was about Fred Ward is this motocross guy who accidentally drives through a time travel experiment on the Baja 500, gets beamed into the Old West, doesn't realize he's in the Old West. And it's this like fish out of water comedy. It's got Peter Coyote in it. It's really good.
Oh, it's so fun.
So yeah, every time I think of William Deere, I think of that movie and how happy that made a kid me.
Yeah, it's in my later years, I always loved the movie, but in my later years, I discovered it's a Fred Decker story, which I never caught in the credits. He didn't do the script, but that was his story, which it's just a fun kind of escape movie, I think, especially for a youth. And again, caught me at the right time. But another tie-in with this and reason I wanted to bring it onto the show, we went to the, I guess, last convention we did was Comic-Con or a horror convention in New Jersey. And one of the guests was Richard Grieco. And we had a moment. We were outside catching a smoke. At that time, I was still smoking. And it was like, I turn around and I'm like, Richard Grieco. And I was like, unbelievable to me. But he was the coolest dude. And yeah, I remember standing out on the boardwalk in one of those what's happening moments in my life. Like, I'm standing here talking to Richard Grieco. Michael Corbin himself is right here. If I only had this VHS for him to sign, I could have gushed. But yeah, that's a fun one. Or if you guys watch it and hate it, I apologize.
That's what I said. We're recommending them, but they may or may not like it.
Yeah. I mean, and this is an ongoing series, so it was very hard to pick just three.
Yeah.
And for whatever reasons to jump over one and go to another. But I think that's what's great about this. It brings up and sparks kind of fun stories and spin-off stories. Now I'm going to have to watch Harry and the Hendersons again. Fans loves that movie.
Richard Grieco.
First class.
Mistaken for a spy.
I can drive this baby out of here. Right now, right?
Yeah.
All I have to do is rescue a beautiful girl, save Europe, graduate high school.
What have you done?
Just what, like this? Hey.
Richard Grieco.
No problem.
If looks could kill. Rated PG-13. Now playing at a theater near you.
Mark, what do you got for your number two?
So my second pick is a movie that I first saw on a no longer with us cable channel called Movie Time. Was it Movie Time? No, it was Encore. It was the early days of Encore, which was always this cable movie channel that was kind of amorphous. It's just like, well, what do they show? Do they show nude stuff? Do they show old stuff? They had hosts, which kind of was unusual. It was like an HBO or Turner Classic, but it was this mix of kind of recent stuff and older stuff, but they had hosts. And this woman, Peary Jones, I believe, was the host, who may have been on E! Later.
I remember Encore. Yeah.
I think it's still around. And I think they're now a bunch, like it's Encore Westerns, Encore Action. But at the time, it was just this one. And I'm going to guess it was within the first couple years of the channel being on. This would have been very late 80s, maybe early 90s, when I was still living at home. And this movie came on and the host was talking about how special and wonderful this movie it was. And it was not easily available on video at that point. And I remember the host in a roundabout way saying, push record now. Basically saying, you might want to record this because it's really good and you can't see it anywhere else. That was always one of the strengths of like Fox Movie Channel was good with that. They would pull all these really obscure things out of the vault that you couldn't get anywhere. And TNT, TCM still does that sometimes. But anyway, this movie from 1968 with Burt Lancaster called The Swimmer, which is unusual. It's a drama. It's a very late 60s drama. It brings to mind Mad Men in a way, in that it's about somebody who appears to be a very successful, popular guy who's really not happy. And the movie opens where you see Burt Lancaster. It's like an overhead shot of Burt Lancaster on a nice summer's day in a bathing suit, just running through the woods. And then he dives into a pool and he comes up and it's one of his neighbor's pools. And he just basically declares that he realized that there is a river of pools between point A and point B in his neighborhood, because it's these affluent suburbanites and everybody has pools. And he realized that the pools formed a river, and he could go from pool to pool and swim home. So it's just him meeting various people and talking to them. And everybody is like, you know, outside with a cocktail this afternoon. And various people you'd recognize. Kim Hunter is in it. Joan Rivers is in it. Might have been one of her earliest film appearances. Mostly not wildly famous people. And the idea is, it's this guy who appears to be a very successful businessman with a perfect family, wife and kids. And as he goes from person to person, the cracks start to appear. And they start reminding him of things he doesn't want to talk about. And it gets darker and darker as it goes. And it's, again, hard to pigeonhole. It's one that, actually, funny enough, Gilbert Gottfried mentions in his podcast occasionally as a movie he loves. And I think he actually co-hosted it on Turner Classic Movies at some point. Like, celebrities come on and they pick a couple movies to talk about with Ben Mankiewicz before they show them. And yeah, it's one I finally found a copy of it on VHS, the old Columbia VHS release, and then a DVD. And then Grindhouse Releasing has a really nice deluxe Blu-ray of it now. I believe Marvin Hamlisch did the music, and the Blu-ray comes with a CD of the soundtrack. And it was based on John Cheever, I could be wrong, short story. And you have somebody doing an audio recording reading of that story, and they talk to, I want to say it's Frank and Eleanor Perry were the directors. I didn't do any research. I'm not looking up anything. I'm just going by memory on this. But it's a lovely 1968 studio shot film, I believe filmed in Connecticut. I think it's set there, but it's pretty devastating by the time it gets to the end. And it's the kind of movie that I would see on TV as a kid that would make me swear off dramas after a while, because it would start really light and happy, and by the end, you know, somebody's dead. or the dog's dead or something like that. And this kind of falls into the category of, it starts with at one tone and it gets progressively darker until it's, I don't want to give anything away, it's not a happy ending.
I'm gonna have to check that one out.
I know
that's the fun of this too, is I'm adding titles to my watch list.
And it's Burt Lancaster, who was always really dependable.
Oh, he was good. Yeah, Burt Lancaster was fantastic.
A man suddenly plunged off a deep end of life. The Swimmer. A story that will be talked about. When you talk about The Swimmer, will you talk about yourself? The Swimmer stars Burt Lancaster.
I'm a very special human being.
Janet Langard.
I bet you never knew I had a big crush on you.
Janice Rule.
I want you to get out of here now, I mean it. I'm expecting someone.
Who?
None of your business, who?
A man?
Do you think I've been in a deep freeze while you've been playing house on the hill? Yes, a man.
When you talk about The Swimmer, will you talk about yourself? The Swimmer, in Technicolor. Suggested for mature audiences.
What's next up for you, Jeff, off the shelf?
Off the shelf, I was going to have to say it's the first World War II movie I ever saw when I was a kid. And I did see it at a drive-in. It was called Von Ryan's Express.
Sinatra.
Yeah, Sinatra. Starred Frank Sinatra and Edward Mulhare. And just a really good cast. It's a really good World War II film. It's fantastic. It's got action. It's got escapes. It's a great movie, and, you know, they're on a train and they're trying to get out of occupied Italy by heading north to Switzerland, and it's just fantastic. They got to sneak through all these depots that are filled with Germans, and it's really a good movie. And Frank Sinatra, I mean, is at his best. I mean,
at the height of his Sinatra, 65,
I think. Yes,
when that film came out. And yeah, that's that's a super fun one. I'm trying to think, as we're talking about some of these, if we've ever had, we never did anything Sinatra up on the screen. We never really had like a war kind of, any war titles really on the screen.
You could do a really great war adventure weekend. You've got Guns and Macaron and Where Eagles Dare.
Yes.
60s.
Yes. And you could run Von Ryan's Express. And if you want more Sinatra, you could run From Here to Eternity.
Heck yeah.
Just great stuff.
That's a great
one. Yep, but I remember seeing that at a drive-in, and I thought, man, that was just the greatest adventure movie. It was just, you know, World War II movie, whatever.
Oh,
I just thought it was excellent.
The larger-than-life kind of appeal of it all on the big screen must have been awesome.
It was. It was really cool. Yep.
You are about to share every fantastic step of the most daring mass escape ever conceived in the mind of man. Only a madman could plan it.
What the hell is this?
Only desperate men fighting for their lives could follow it. Only a hijacked prison train could blast them on their frenzied dash to freedom. From the great bestseller comes this story of an incredible American pilot down behind enemy lines in Italy.
Ryan Joseph L., Colonel United States Army Air Corps, 0718359. Don't you salute senior officers in your army, Major?
Who does this cocky, overbearing Ryan character think he is?
I'm the ranking officer here, Major. What I say goes. Is that clear, mister?
You better know what you're doing, unless you want a mutiny on your hands.
Why do 600 prisoners of war hate him worse than Hitler?
You get your eye crossed now, Von Ryan.
Is this man they call Von Ryan traitor or hero? How does he turn a prison hell train into his own highballing headquarters for his private war against the Nazis? Suspense that races from the toe of the Italian boot, through Rome, to the tip of the Swiss Alps. From the base of your spine to the edge of your nerves, as Von Ryan's boxcar commandos erupt in a blast of action all over the map. Betrayal at Pescara. Masquerade at Verona.
Americanish, ne?
A beautiful stowaway who makes her move at Bologna.
Why don't you close the door?
And relentless, breathtaking Nazi pursuit every foot of the way. It takes a madman to run this gauntlet of death. It takes guts and glory, arrogance and fury. It takes the man they call Von Ryan.
Well, my next pick from 93, I don't recall seeing this at a movie theater. My first memories are seeing this on HBO. And it's just like, I think Stand By Me caught me as a kid. I feel like maybe this was an appeal of getting a little bit older, but still had that same friendly camaraderie to it all. The movie is called Indian Summer.
That movie is good.
Oh, yes. My gosh. I go back to this movie pretty regularly. And since the whole drive-in magic carpet has taken off, there's such a weird connection with this movie and I think what we're doing and what we do. The premise of the movie is that a group of friends come back to kind of a summer camp reunion. And the same guys running it is played by the amazing Alan Arkin in probably my favorite role he's ever been in. He plays Uncle Lou, who runs this, you know, camp that pretty much these kids have memories from every single summer growing up, all the relationships that they made together, all the, you know, ups and downs of their lives. And then they all come together when they're in their 30s and they've lived their lives and they come back to this place that meant so much to them and kind of stands for a place of their youth and a place of their happiness. And they start reliving some of these memories. They pretty much just stay at the camp. And there's a lot of really funny moments in the movie. It's got an amazing cast. Diane Lane, Bill Paxton, Kevin Pollak, Elizabeth Perkins, who I love. Sam Raimi pops up.
I remember seeing the TV ads when it came out at the time, and they didn't make a big deal about the fact that Sam Raimi was acting in it, because, I mean, most people didn't know who he was, but I did. And
yeah.
I saw the ads. I'm like, wait, is that Sam Raimi in this movie?
I know. It's crazy. He plays like a goofy kind of assistant to Uncle Lou. It's such an amazing, heartfelt movie that is played incredibly well. The portrayals of the characters are all beautiful, but spoiler alert, if you plan to watch this movie, in the end, it's revealed that Lou is planning on selling the camp. And this group that now has had another amazing adventure together, pulled together to save a place that meant everything to them.
Yes.
And two of them step up and decide, you know, we're gonna put our whole lives and our whole heart into this place to make sure people are able to have these amazing experiences moving on summer to summer. And it's a movie that probably didn't do well. Like, I know I didn't see anything about it when it was coming out in the movies. It was an HBO kind of, you know, let's get it out there movie, but it's one that, you know, as a writer and somebody who's a lover of dramatic film and drama getting to the heart of an audience, it just struck me really, really well and is the type of movie that I'd love to make one day. Just full heart, full kind of friendship. And it's a hangout movie. Every time I watch this movie, it just makes me feel like I'm hanging out with old friends that I haven't seen in a while. So really, really fun one for you guys to check out if you haven't checked it out.
Yeah. No, I'm right with you, Virgil. I saw it when it first came out and I loved it. I thought it was great.
Oh, so great. You know, and like I said, having that that connection now with a group of friends all coming back together to save something that they love, it's certainly relatable at this point, you know?
Yeah, so. It's just like our drive-in. The same people, we see the same people. We miss them over the winter. We don't see them for 6 months. And then when we open, everybody's back again, and it's great.
That's right, it's summer camp.
From Touchstone Pictures, they're eight lifelong friends who are going back to summer camp.
Let the games begin.
Going back to forget their worries.
You rich?
Not even close.
Too bad, you've gotten kind of sexy.
But what started as fun and games became a week they'd never forget.
I hope I didn't offend any of you.
No, who said that?
Indian Summer, rated PG-13.
What do you got, Mark, for your number three?
For number three, so I'm a big Beatle fan, and I'm a big Monty Python fan. And there are multiple ways that those two groups cross paths. And one of them, actually the earliest one, is a movie from 1970 called The Magic Christian. And this is based on a Terry Southern book. Terry Southern also wrote Easy Rider, and he was a sort of a counterculture-y, wacky, of the time, late 60s kind of writer. And it stars Peter Sellers again and Ringo Starr and a lot of cameos. The idea basically is Peter Sellers plays Sir Guy Grand, who is just a rich guy in London who gets off on seeing what people will do for money, how far they'll go for money. So he's always offering people money to do ridiculous things or just setting up these weird pranks. And he meets Ringo, who plays like a homeless hippie in a park, and he adopts him as his son, and they just go around these little adventures. It's very, very sketchy. It's not dubious or of irreputable reputation. It's sketchy in that it's very segmented. Written by Graham Chapman and John Cleese. This might have been right before, right around the time Python started. So you see them in a scene. Yul Brynner is in an incredibly memorable scene. Raquel Welch is in an incredibly memorable scene. Christopher Lee shows up more or less playing Dracula. Richard Attenborough, I think, is in it somewhere. It's all kinds of well-known faces. So it basically jumps around all these people. You know, Peter Sellers tries to bribe one of the big British, what do they call it? Crew. What's the name for it? And they it's a sport, but they call it crew. It's in a long boat. And they do it on a river. It's like a boat race where all these people are rowing. Maybe they just call it rowing.
No, I don't think it's called rowing.
Is it not? They're in these big long boats that are they're like two teams and they row against each other.
Yes.
This shows my complete ignorance and lack of interest in sports of any kind. Anyway, there's a scene where Peter Sellers is trying to like bribe Oxford to throw the race against the other team. And things like that. And eventually they go on a luxury liner, which is the titular Magic Christian. And they just do all kinds of wacky things on there. It's really off the wall and weird. The score is done entirely by Badfinger, who I'm a huge fan of.
Hell yeah.
So, and the soundtrack album that was, I think it was on an obscure label. Commonwealth United, I think, put the movie out. It might've been Tetragrammaton or somebody like that who put out the album. Right. It was all Badfinger stuff, and Something in the Air by Thunderclap Newman is in it. So it's got a really good soundtrack, and it's just wild and wacky. It feels pretty Pythonic, and it's Peter Sellers being silly and goofy and putting on accents and things, and Ringo's there. So it's a movie I love. It's available, I think Olive Films, I want to say, has it out on Blu-ray, so it's not hard to find. And it's one that I discovered out of my love for all the things that are the elements of it. I love Python. I love the Beatles. I love Peter Sellers. I love Badfinger. And I'm like, what? There's a movie with all of these ingredients? And I rented it at the time. And I've always had a copy since I first saw it, like when I was in junior high. So it's a not movie for everybody. Not everybody might like it, but it's very of that moment in time. And it's just fun.
It's not the Beatles Python crossover I thought you were going to say. I thought you were going to go to the Ruddles.
Ruddles, I love the Ruddles. Now, there was a sequel that Eric Idle did in like the 90s called All You Need, no, what was it called? Was it called Can't Buy Me Lunch? I don't know. There was a sequel where
I think Michael Jackson was in it. It was called All You Need Are Gloves.
The original Ruddles is amazing. That's available on DVD and Blu-ray. I think it's on YouTube too. And then years later, Idle did a sequel, which was just more of the same. It was rehashing footage and then interviewing more contemporary people about why the Ruddles were great. It wasn't very good, but the original Ruddles is great. And it's got George Harrison and it's got half the Pythons are involved, or at least two. And no, there were a lot of crossovers. I mean, George Harrison became a movie producer. So he produced Life of Brian. Yeah. And, you know, he produced Time Bandits, which has several of the Pythons in it. So they were hand in hand for a long time.
The world's richest man and the world's poorest boy are getting it ready now.
And everybody everywhere will be a little worse off for it.
Well then, Youngman Grand. Father. And you know it's right. Presenting the most irreverent, irrelevant father and son team
since the Frankensteins. Dad? Do you think words corrupt?
I don't know. Let's try. Agnes?
Yes?
Nipple. I have it on the best of authority that Ringo Starr is the magic Christian.
Can't we settle our differences amicably?
No, son, no.
Some bird told me that Peter Sellers is the magic Christian.
You needn't eat the plastic. I just wanted to see if you had your price. Most of us do.
Oxford, can you hear me?
I mean, you've actually come here to offer us money to interfere with the race.
Come out immediately.
Yes, that's right.
You should realize, sir, that Oxford men cannot be bought.
Hear, hear.
Who knows what evil lurks in the heart of man?
The magic Christian do. I say, Dad, shouldn't we tell them the real identity of the magic Christian?
Heaven only knows, son. Heaven only knows. The magic Christian is a miraculous conception.
Jeff, what do you got? Number three off the wall.
Number three off the wall is a James Stewart movie. It's called Flight of the Phoenix.
Ooh, yeah.
It's really an excellent movie about this plane that crashes in the desert. And they're there they start to think, well, nobody's even looking for us anymore because it's been a couple of weeks. So before they lose all their strength, because, you know, there's hardly any water. In fact, they're cooking the antifreeze from the engine of the airplane in order to make water.
Yeah.
They're distilling it. So before they all run out of energy, they start to build another plane out of the wrecked parts of the first one. They build another one. And they actually fly it out of there. It is just unbelievable, but it's great. I mean, Jimmy Stewart, Richard Attenborough. Oh, I can't forget the German guys. There's a German guy in it, and you know they kind of
Richard
don't like
Attenborough him. Before Richard Attenborough was running Jurassic Park.
He said,
"If I have one wish in life, if I make it out of this desert alive, I'm going to have a dinosaur park."
Yeah.
He made that dream come true.
Yeah. In this movie, in Flight of the Phoenix, he's the co-pilot to Jimmy Stewart, and he drinks a little too much. And oh my gosh, Ernest Borgnine is in it.
What? Part of Borgnine.
Ernest Borgnine is in it. I can't remember the name of the German guy, but he's a famous actor. But it's really got a really great cast, and they all play really good parts. And it's a fairly long movie. It's over 2 hours, but it's just great.
I haven't seen it in years because when I was running the video store, they actually remade that movie.
Yes, they did.
And I think it was right around the time they made a movie called Sahara as well. But the remake had What the heck was that guy's name?
Is it Dennis Quaid?
Dennis Quaid. Yes, Dennis Quaid and a couple other stars of the time.
Yeah.
But yeah, gosh, I'll have to go back and rewatch that because, gosh, I think that remake came out. It must have been like early
2000s. 2004.
Yeah. There you go. Yep. I was still at the video store. And that would have been when I did it. That's what I would love doing whenever movies came in for the week is, you know, I'd kind of do a little research on each title and try to see what connections I could make to the old works or the directors or whatever the case is.
Yeah. And I was actually fortunate enough to pick up Flight of the Phoenix. The original was Jimmy Stewart. I actually have that on 16 millimeter.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
I love a good adventure movie, a good adventure survival movie.
Oh, absolutely. It's fantastic. Yeah. They crash land in a desert. Well, I did say that. Yeah. And how they build another plane out of the wrecked one. It's just really cool.
Survival.
Yep.
I used to get this movie confused and combined in my mind with, there's a Twilight Zone episode with Cliff Robertson about him waking up in the desert near a wrecked plane. And then there is another TV movie that was made in the 70s called Soul Survivor about the same thing. And I had seen Soul Survivor and the Twilight Zone episode. And when I'd heard about Flight of the Phoenix, like, I think I've seen that. Is Cliff Robertson in it? No. Okay, then I guess I haven't seen that. So it's funny how you sort of take films with similar elements and kind of put them in a blender in your head sometimes. But
if you decide you haven't seen it, Mark, you got to check it out. It's a great movie.
I love it.
I did watch it around the time that the remake came out.
Oh, okay.
Because I didn't really have a lot of interest in the remake. And yeah. It's great. It's just, yeah. It's one of those solid 60s adventure movies.
Don't forget to put it down in your diary. How very, very nice it was at the party here till the booze run out.
It's not a party. There is no booze. It is a most unusual motion picture where the excitement never runs out. This was the best-selling novel of man's pride and fury. And this is the motion picture, exulting in the vastness of human hope and human courage to scale new heights of adventure. Nine men whose very lives turn on one of the most startling, ironic twists of fate you have ever experienced in a motion picture. Unusual men. Superb performances from a cast of brilliant stars assembled from around the world. Sometimes, a motion picture sets the screen on fire.
Well, there you have it. And it's kind of like, yeah. I thought it was going to fall. You know, you got a nice wide span there of recommendations and you get a feel for the type of things that we love and we like and get inspiration from. So this is a fun idea. I think the idea of us going off the wall is a nice way to, you know, change things up a little bit. Mark's been doing an amazing job locking in the guests, which, like we talked about, it adds a timeless element to the podcast. When we're talking about what's coming up for the month of May in 2022, you know, it loses its appeal after 2022 is over. But
right.
When you're talking about getting information about the drive-in culture and people responsible for elements of the drive-in culture, and we're talking timeless movies, it really does add that element where you can go back to the podcast at any time, regardless of when you're discovering it, and get that pleasure out of it. So hopefully this is something you guys really enjoy. And like we always say, if you want to get even more involved, jump over to the Patreon, which really has lifted off the ground in the off season. Mark's done an incredible job offering the virtual screenings, which if you don't know, every month we do an in-person exclusive Patreon only screening, but we were able to carry that over into the virtual setting, and we're having so much fun with it. We announced we're going to try to carry on and do once a month, offer that as well during the on season.
Yeah.
We've heard from a few people who have said, even though they live not too far from the drive-in, they just can't make it out for those Thursday night single features. So with the virtual screenings, people, anybody who's a Patreon member, even if they live in California or Australia or Austria or Alabama, can make it. And the virtual screenings feel like you're at our theater. We have a DJ set that we record ahead of time for an hour. We've got, unbeknownst to Jeff, we have Jeff's pre-recorded voice introducing and back announcing the film. And we have vintage trailers and snack bar ads all transferred from 35, and something from the American Genre Film Archive Library is a secret feature every time. So people really tend to enjoy it.
It's great. Yeah. And we want to tell the people there's one coming up.
That's right. Yeah. Every single month we got one dropping on you guys. And actually, as we're recording this, we have one coming up tomorrow. So yes. If you guys are into it, Mark, why don't you give them the deets on how they can jump in and support the Patreon?
If you want to be a Patreon of us, not to be patronizing, I mean, you can do that too, but we prefer not to hear it. If you want to be a Patreon, unless it's the money patronizing, in which case that's cool. If you want to be a Patreon member, if you go to patreon.com/Mahoning Drive-In, all the details are there. It's three levels. It's a $4.99, a $9.99, and a $19.99. Each has different levels of goods. And of course, as you go up that ladder, you get everything that the previous levels had. At the very base, if you're a Patreon member at all, at $4.99, you get a membership card, laminated membership card with your name on it and a unique number. And that can be used at the theater for discounts and things, as can the Simplex members. The top level at $19.99, you get, I believe it's 10% discount on snack bar or Mahoning merch on site. You get a free enamel pin each year that's a different design, and you get the free monthly screenings, which are a lot of fun. The ones that we do in person are 35 millimeter from our collection or from other collectors on film, a secret feature. We won't tell you what it is until it hits the screen. Vintage trailers, all that stuff, and DJ set. It's like a little private party at the theater. It's usually not too big a group. I think we've had maybe 50 or 60 maximum at one of those in-person shows.
They're great. It's that personal setting, you know?
Yeah.
Where it feels like you know everybody. It's like the old days of the Mahoning. You know, it's a nice collective, tight-knit group.
Yep, absolutely.
And then the monthly screenings, also the virtual versions, are pretty much a recreation of that experience. We do that via Zoom. You can chat along, text chat along if you like or not, just watch the movie. And those usually run, the DJ set starts at 7 p.m. Eastern time. Those go an hour or so. And then the feature is a single feature. Those usually, program runs about 2 hours. So it's not too late on a weeknight. And it's a way to sort of get that Mahoning fix when we're closed or if you can't make it out.
So yeah, join in the fun. And as you guys know, end of April, opening back up, Oz and Wonka. You guys can get all the details at MahoningDIT.com. We're pretty much releasing a new event every 2 days, which is really, really exciting. I love this time of the year. I may have said it on the last podcast, but it's so rewarding to do all that hard work in the off season and releasing it out to the world and having them freak out. It's very rewarding. So
yeah.
Can't wait to get back in the groove. So,
and releasing events this early, at least as of when we're recording this, gives people a lot more time to plan. As we know, a lot of people travel, you have to take time off work, or you might want to book a hotel room or whatever. But I know a lot of people appreciate the more advanced warning they can get for shows. So I think you said by the time we open, we should have more than half of our season announced.
That's the plan, because last year we got just bottlenecked. We were adding new events. We were shifting things around. Big events were coming in and we were announcing events pretty much up until the last month that we were open. So we're hoping we
can
just get everything out, focus on promoting those events as they're approaching and roll into things like we did back in the old days when we could do a lot more during the week promotion instead of, hey, look forward to this thing that's coming in a couple months as well.
Right, right.
As you leave the theater, folks, please be careful. Don't let this happen to your car. Be sure to remove the speaker before you leave. If you should accidentally pull a speaker loose, please turn it in at our snack bar or box office. Thank you.
Always a treat chatting with you guys. Nice laid back episode. And of course, we will be back with another episode likely next week. So until then, Jeff, take it away, my friend.
Ladies and gentlemen, thanks again for coming out tonight to the Mahoning Drive-In Theater. We hope you'll come back and see us again real soon. The exit is on the right-hand side of the screen at the front of the field, and most importantly, Have a very safe trip home. Good night and God bless you.